Thank you. What our eyes have seen and our ears have heard. Your wonderful, glorious, majestic, and all of your persons. We come before you asking that you fill us with your spirit in order that we might be able to talk to your people, hide me behind your cross, that your people may not see me, but all of you on today. You remind to think, mouth to speak in such a way that you might be glorified. We pray for the broken heart, downtrodden, and so which word one might be lifted on this day. Now, let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, pray that it be acceptable in thy sight, all of you, Lord, and none of me. It is in Jesus' name we ask it all. Amen. All of God's children said amen. We are so grateful and thankful to the Lord for making our appearing possible on today. And so we give honor to him from whom all of our blessings flow. Honor to the clergy on today, Reverend Anderson. Honor to Reverend Williams. In his absence, to our deacons. Honor to you.
Bless you.
Honor to leaders of our church and to you, my sisters and brothers in Christ and creation. Man, it is good to be here on another Lord's Day. And man, I'm thankful that he's blessed all of us to be able to be a part of it and be blessed thus far. We are so grateful to our praise team this morning for rendering those selections and getting us off to a grand start. Man, today we're going to continue in our series of preaching the road to recovery. And as we've been examining the book of Nehemiah, we want to continue in this series of preaching. Last Sunday we talked about before God uses us, that there are some things that we need to consider, some stages that we go through prior to God using us for his purposes and for his glory. And I want to remind everyone that if you are a blood-washed believer, God wants to use your life in order to glorify him to others. So we want to make another installment this morning on that same note and same series of preaching the road to recovery. Go with me to Nehemiah chapter 2, and I want to just read verses 4 and 5. Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. I think it's appropriate scripture that we could consider as we are in the week of Thanksgiving. We read from this scripture, Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. We're all standing for the reading and reverence of his word. Hear the word of God. Then the king said unto me, for what dost thou make request? So I prayed to the God of heaven. And I said unto the king, if it please the king, and if thy servant have found favor, say favor.
Amen.
If thou servant have found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me unto Judah, unto the city of my father's sepulchres, that I may build it. You may be seated in the presence of God. Nehemiah said to the king, if it please the king, and if thy servant have found favor in thy sight. I want to tag this text from which to preach. I want to talk from this subject for just a few moments. The favor of God on the road to recovery. The favor of God on the road to recovery. I'm so grateful this morning because it is the week, the Sunday prior to Thanksgiving. This Thursday, we'll all pause. It'll be kind of different this year because CDC, Center for Disease Control, has advised families not to come together for Thanksgiving. And it's kind of different this year because we're in the midst of a pandemic. It's been requested that we limit our travel, that we limit our exposures, that we scale back what we typically do because of the times. We're living in a time where there is a disease that's taking over our country. And it seems like it's a bad dream that y'all be waking up from one day, but I don't know, 9 months later, I ain't woke up yet. And it's like a dream that keeps getting worse and worse and worse to the extent that our holidays are being affected. Can't go see grandmother, can't go see uncles and aunts, can't have all these folk over to my house for Thanksgiving. Because you may bring more than just ham and macaroni and cheese. You mess around bringing that virus with you. And we. So they've asked us to limit what we do. But what I was thinking about it is Thanksgiving. And whether I'm at my loved one's house or whether I'm at my house, it does not limit how grateful I am. I don't know about you. I am going to limit my activity. I'm going to restrict folk from coming over. I'm going to watch what I do during the holiday season. But guess what? I will not put limits on my Thanksgiving. No, God has been too good to me. So wherever I am, wherever I'm doing, I'm going to pause and tell God, thank you. Thank you for helping me. Thank you for watching over me. Death all around me, but you kept me. Aren't you glad of God's keeping power? That if he didn't give you a new car, he didn't change your address, he didn't give you that promotion on your job, you're still making the same money, but he kept you. Glad. Thank nothing. I'm kept by the power. God has kept me. Yeah. I don't know about you, folk getting sick. And I haven't gotten sick. I'm kept. I don't know what'll happen tomorrow, but right now, he's been keeping me. And so what, where we at, what we're doing, you know, who's coming over, what's on the agenda has nothing to do with how grateful I am. And part of my gratefulness comes from the fact that I don't know why he does it. I don't know why he's doing it. I don't know why he'll continue to do it. But one of the things that I'm grateful for is that I carry God's favor. I hadn't done anything to earn it. I hadn't done anything to require God to give it to me. He doesn't owe it to me, yet he's granted me his favor. Fact that I'm standing here preaching to you, that he's given me favor. Not only has he given me favor, he's given you favor too. Listen, what is favor? Favor, here it is. Favor is a divine kindness or an act of true compassion on the part of God himself toward needy and undeserving human beings. That's what favor is. Want me to say it again? Favor is the divine kindness or an act of true compassion on the part of God toward needy and undeserving human beings. I don't know about you, but I'm needy. I have needs. I have desires. I have things that make life easier. And God knows if He doesn't do something extra for me, those needs won't be fulfilled. And so for some reason, God shows kindness towards me. Aren't you glad, sisters and brothers, that God, to some extent, has shown you kindness? He's given you favor, not because you've deserved it, not because you've said the right things, not because you've gone the right places, not because you've made the right connections, but in spite of all of that, still He's kind toward you. I'm grateful, sisters and brothers, that in the midst of this pandemic that we're living in, God is being kind to me. And I discovered, sisters and brothers, that this favor that God gives is not just for me to have a better quality of life. God's granted me favor, sisters and brothers, so that I can help others enjoy a better quality of life. Let me tell you, when you want to know what real favor, folk restrict favor when they limit it to what they drive. I drive this because God gave me favor. I live here because God gave me favor. You live it where you want to live, you're driving what you want to drive, but you ain't helping nobody. No, God grants us favor. He grants us kindness. Why? So we can show kindness and favor to others. That's what we need to be mindful of, sisters and brothers, of why God is really blessing you. He's really blessing you. So number one, you can tell folk that it's Him that's blessing you. But also so you can turn around and be a blessing to somebody else. That's why He's allowed you to be here. That's why He's allowed you to do what you're doing. That's why He's allowed you to live in the manner in which you're living. Not so you can hoard it and keep it to yourself. It's so you can turn around and be a blessing to others. And let me tell you something, sisters and brothers. You want to see God's favor ignited in you? Pick up an agenda that's bigger than you. Huh? If you want to see the favor of God stand out in your life and be visible for the whole world to see, look for something to do other than just blessing yourself. When you desire to be a blessing to others, the favor of God is ignited in you. Why? Because it's not just for you. It's going to be a blessing to somebody else. That's what His favor is for. And that's what we see visible in our text today. Last week, we began studying the story of Nehemiah. He got word that his hometown, the condition of Jerusalem, was in disrepair, and to the extent where the walls were in heaps of rubble, the gate, the entrance into the sea, the marquee or the landmark of Jerusalem had been destroyed, and it pricked the heart of Nehemiah to the extent that prior to being moved to a position of authority, it pricked Nehemiah's heart as he examined the suffering that Israel had gone through. And so we found out, we closed out our sermon on last Sunday, that Nehemiah prayed. Nehemiah prayed. His heart was pricked. He was moved. His emotions were moved to the extent that he
pray that God would ease the suffering of Israel. And I don't know about you, sisters and brothers, that, but we need to understand that the power of prayer is available to all of us who desire to be used by God. Yeah. Nehemiah prays, and out of the prayers of Nehemiah, God sets up circumstances to be a blessing to the nation of Israel. Nehemiah prays, don't miss this. Nehemiah prays, and God sets up circumstances where the nation of Israel is ultimately blessed. God is going to use Nehemiah, but Israel will be the result. Israel being blessed will be the result of God using Nehemiah. I'm telling you again, God wants to use you to bless more than just you. He wants to use you, show you favor, show you kindness, in order that you can be a blessing to others. Listen. The news of Israel and its condition really had bothered Nehemiah. I don't know about you, but there are some things in life that can bother you. To the extent that, you ever had anything to get on your nerves? Yeah. You ever had anything to get on your last nerve? Well, it affected your emotions because something was on your mind. You're bothered by something, and it's really internal, but after a while, after you start getting on your nerves, folk can see it externally. You ever had a problem or something start worrying you on the inside, and before long, folk were able to see it on the outside? This is Nehemiah. Because as we move into chapter 2, Nehemiah was in service to the king. Now, I told you last week, he was a cupbearer. But he was a cupbearer to the king. It seems as if it's a low position, but it's really a position of kind of prominence, because you're right where the king is. You're in the seat of government authority. You can touch the king, and you're entrusted with the position of bearing his cup. It seemed like a flunky position. You're the cupbearer. But look who you holding the cup for. All right. So you must take that into consideration. And being the cupbearer, part of your job was your disposition. How you look, how you carried yourself, your emotions. If you were having a bad day, you were not to express it in front of the king. Why? Because the king always had to have everything right in front of him. They even had court jesters where when the king was in a bad mood, they would bring jesters in just to make him laugh. And so the cupbearer, he could not walk around having a bad day. But this particular day, something was wrong. What was going on the inside of Nehemiah was now visible on the outside. Look what the scripture says in verse 1, chapter 2. And it came to pass in the month of Nisan, and the 20th year of Artaxerxes the king, that wine was before him. And I took up the wine, this is Nehemiah, and gave it unto the king. Now look what the scripture says. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Prior to this moment, Nehemiah has never ever expressed but one emotion before the king, and that was gladness and happiness. But on this particular day, the king observed the sadness of Nehemiah. Huh? Listen, sisters and brothers, when you have the favor of God and you're using it on the road to recovery, first thing you need to understand is you need protection in favor. Huh? See, favor, sisters and brothers, means that God will be with you. He'll show his kindness towards you, but it's typically as you're doing something for his agenda. That's what God gives you favor for. Not so you can walk around and be in conversations talking about, I got favor. But no, as you serve him, he will exhibit his favor and his kindness towards you. In other words, you'll be successful because of his favor.
Come on now, preach.
So a lot of times, you can take on tough stuff if you have God's favor. But the tougher it is, the more protection you're going to need.
Yeah.
And so we need to see, number one, the protection in the favor that God gives. And look at what he says. It says he had not been before time sad in his presence. So it's a dangerous time for Nehemiah. How will the king react to someone being sad in his presence? Do you know king could have you executed for not having the right countenance in his presence? Well, look at the scripture. You gotta remember, he's got God's favor. He's got God's kindness. Look what the scripture says. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? Huh? We see God's protection in the reaction of the king. King could have snapped his fingers at the disposition of Nehemiah. But God gives the king a probing spirit. You know what I see? I see not only does Nehemiah have favor in God's sight, but I see that God has given Nehemiah favor in the king's sight. You know, sometimes, sisters and brothers, God will give you favor in the presence of folk that ain't even supposed to like you. But he'll give you favor. God will give you favor with folk that can't even stand your guts. They don't even know why they're blessing you, yet they blessing you anyhow. Why? It ain't because you smart. It ain't because of your degree. It ain't because of where you went to school. It ain't because of your pedigree. It's because God is showing his overwhelming kindness towards you. It's protection.
Come on.
The king doesn't overreact. That's God's protection. Huh? He says, you don't look right, Nehemiah. Man, we're used to you having a good attitude. What's wrong? That's God's protection. Because the king could, lose his temper. But God has given Nehemiah favor in the king's presence. He says, king has a, he sees it. He says, this is nothing else but sorrow of the heart. Nehemiah, something done broke your heart. Huh? He's been read by the king. The king pronounces his judgment, and see the result of Nehemiah. The scripture says, then I was very sore afraid. I love this because this picture of favor gives a true portrait of favor. It leads us to our second point. Not only do we see the protection in favor, but we see number two, the price of favor. Oftentimes we think about when a person has favor, that they're always on the mountaintop, that they're always in a position of prominence. Nehemiah has favor. He has favor from God. He has favor from the king. But guess what? Nehemiah is afraid. There's a price that comes with favor. Why? Because when you have God's favor, his expectations are higher. He's going to trust you with the tough stuff because he's giving you favor to do the tough stuff. But guess what? When you think about doing the tough stuff and you don't know what's on the other side of the tough stuff, it can make you afraid. Nehemiah, he has favor, but he's afraid. Have you ever knew God, you know God loves you, been in this moment that you know God loves you, but you're still terrified?
Yeah.
Huh? You know you belong to him? Mm. Huh? But you still don't know what to do?
Yeah.
Nehemiah, he has God's favor. God has set things up in order for him to be used by him, and Nehemiah is afraid. Here's the price. That's the price. The price of favor. Price of favor, sisters and brothers, means that you'll have some uncomfortable moments. When you have God's favor, it doesn't mean that you'll always know what to do. Huh? Having God's favor is trusting him to know what to do. And when I'm preaching, don't miss it. He's trusting, having God's favor is you not having the right answer. It's trusting God to have the right answer. Having favor doesn't mean that you'll always make the decision, but it means that God has set it up where the decision is crystal clear. Having favor, sisters and brothers, don't mean that you'll always be the one standing on top, but having God's favor means at the end of it all, he'll get the glory. He'll get the praise. Folks will wave their hands and look to him. And the price that come with favor. Never thought that you need protection in favor. Yeah, you do.
Yeah.
You need protection in favor because some situations there's nobody trusting God but you. Huh? And it will make you afraid.
Yeah.
When you're the only one looking to God, you know the answers in him.
Yeah.
But if you're the only one looking,
okay,
it will make you uneasy. Well, I'm closing. This morning, sisters and brothers, God has set it up for Nehemiah to be used by him. Huh? He sets it up. But notice, sisters and brothers, the steps that he takes Nehemiah through first. He allows Nehemiah to observe his protection. Nehemiah, because he's been in the court of the king, because he's been in the presence of the king before, I didn't tell you this, but he's probably been in service to the king about 3 years. He knows how this court operates. He knows what happens when people are caught being wrong in the presence of the king. Huh? And so, sisters and brothers, he had his heart pricked in chapter 1. He prayed about it in chapter 1. Now God is setting Nehemiah up to be used by him. But he takes him through the steps. He makes him see first the protection and favor. And then he sees the price in favor. But here come the shouting stuff now. Mm-hmm. I want to close with the provisions that come with favor. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sisters and brothers, here's the thing about God. When God wants to do something, resources are never ever a problem. Listen. Here's something to think about when you want to be used mightily by God and it requires resources. Listen, if you really want to move the kingdom of God towards the purposes that God is using you, always make sure that what you're caught up in is going to bless more folk than just you. God will send resources to bless those that don't have resources, and he'll send those resources through you. Too many times, sisters and brothers, God wants to send resources through us, but they get backed up in us, kind of like a water hose. When you put a kink in the water hose, the water won't flow. Sometimes we that kink in the water hole, blessing get to us, and then it get a kink in the line. Blessing can't get through to the other side. But when God wants to use his men or women, and he grants them favor, with his favor comes provisions. In other words, whatever you need, because you have his favor, God will grant your need. And I'm telling you this about God. If it doesn't exist and you need it, God will create it. Have I got a witness? If it requires money, God will send the resources in order for you to be a blessing, yes, to somebody else. With God's favor, there are provisions. Look at what the word says. The Bible says that the king asked Nehemiah, what is it that you need? Nehemiah told the king, I want to go back home and I want to rebuild those walls and I want to rebuild that gate.